the bass. No one owes you anything, I think. You need a shotgun blast, a kick in the ass. So paranoid, watch your back!
And good Friday, October 5. Hello, everybody. Thanks a lot for taking us along. Wherever you're going, whatever you may be doing, we appreciate you taking us along for the ride. And welcome to Indiana Sports Beat with Jim Coyle. Justin Kalen, high atop the crew chief's box this morning.
That's right.
Hope your day is off to a good one, and I hope your week has been a good one, and you're ready for the weekend. I certainly am. Before we get any further in there, let's get to the headlines.
All right, here are your headlines for this Friday, October 5th. Brought to you by Billy Joe's Gas and Food Mart, located on Highway 150 in Floyd's Knobs. The Patriots defeat the Colts 38-24 last night on Thursday Night Football. Major League Baseball playoffs well underway as the Brewers defeat the Rockies 3-2 and the Dodgers defeat the Braves 6-0. The playoffs will resume today with all four games in action. It will be Game 2 for the Brewers and Rockies, Game 2 for the Dodgers and Braves, and Games 1 for the Astros, Indians, and Yankees. And Red Sox. Those are your headlines on this Friday, October 5th, brought to you by Billy Joe's Gas and Food Mart, located on Highway 150 in Floyd's Knobs. Make sure you stop in for your hot breakfast, fill your gas tank, or hit up the daily lunch special, $5.99 today, hot wings and wedges.
And there you go. Lots going on, baseball playoffs. Baseball's fun during the playoffs.
Absolutely. So it's kind of like hockey. I don't like hockey until
it's like the NBA.
Playoffs. Yeah, exactly. Yep.
NFL is the only sport that people watch during the entire season. Like watching during the entire season.
Yeah.
But Dodgers in action last night. They crushed whoever it was they played.
Atlanta.
I can't believe Atlanta's in the playoffs.
Oh, Atlanta's good.
Are they good this year?
They're pretty good. Yeah, I don't think they'll beat the Dodgers, but they're pretty good.
The Milwaukee Brewers. That's got to be good for baseball in the fact that Milwaukee's not a large market.
Yeah. That series is for the beer lovers. Miller Park versus Coors Field.
There you go.
Too bad St. Louis isn't in it. We could have Bushfield represented as well.
I was going to say, they can't say this bud's for you. Lots going on this weekend. The Indiana Hoosiers taking on the Ohio State Buckeyes. Colts and the Patriots last night. You know, that is the eighth straight win by the Patriots in that series.
No surprise.
Tom Brady is 6-0 against Captain Andrew Luck. Wonder what his latest posting will be.
That's see if he posted one last night.
Drew Davis is along for the ride today. We'll get caught up on any and all recruiting news from Pegs.com. Also, Sammy Jacobs from Hoosier Huddle will set the stage for the Ohio State game in Indiana tomorrow. I had planned on having Xander Diamond and Maurice Creek on today. Unfortunately, both of those have to be rescheduled. Mo's over in a...
So I'm sitting here working on WhatsApp.
He's over there with Borat in Kazakhstan. Where is he?
Ukraine.
Yeah, he's in the Ukraine. Ends up, he'll be on live, but ended up, he's having practice right now. Or a film session one. I'm not kidding.
Coach, I got to step out and do a radio show. You mind if I come right back? That's fantastic. You all right over there?
A little sneeze.
Man.
Hit the sneeze button. But, and then, of course, Xander, he's out in California. And so that's a whole time deal. I got to go the other direction.
I was wondering about that yesterday.
That's 10-hour difference time between those two. 10 hours. That would be amazing. I have them both on the same time or same day. That'll be funny. So I'm looking forward to that. But we'll get those guys on soon. Mitchell Page will be on probably next week. So a big week next week. So make sure you're keeping up with us. Do so by following us on Facebook. You can find the rebroadcast, podcast, each day on iTunes, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Google Play, or IndianaSportsBeat.com. Sign up and you'll just have them delivered. They'll be there waiting for you. You never miss a beat on Indiana Sports Beat.
That's nice and easy.
That's right.
Also, don't forget about the text line, 502-414-1450 is that number.
Yeah, because today I want to hear a lot going on with the FBI corruption, college basketball corruption trials. We're going to get into that. And I want to hear from what the folks think. 502-414-1450. Have you been keeping up with it? Have you been following it? What are your thoughts, questions, comments? Fire up today. You're going to participate. It's going to be a fan participation show today.
That's right. Also going to have a giveaway, correct?
Oh, yeah. Free Lunch Friday, of course, from Bubba's. And a little more. May do a couple. Calendars. IU basketball calendars. Got some of those for you. So make sure you're a participant. Had to figure out something good, easy to give it away. I'm not trying to make it hard.
Well, last time we thought it was easy, and then it didn't get any responses.
I waited too late for one.
Yeah, that's true.
And for a forget, you know, this hour is brought to you by friends at Kentuckiana's Premier Truck Center. Whether it's one truck or the entire fleet, Kentuckiana Premier Truck Center has got your company covered for sales or service. They've got locations in Louisville and Clarksville, Indiana. Give John or Aaron a call. Whether it's Eno, Volvo, Cummings, or Mack, they are the experts, and they handle any and everything. Bring in your truck or fleet today. Make sure you support those who support you. Don't forget that if you're a long-haul driver or a truck driver. Check out our friends at Kentuckiana's Premier Truck Center. Also, Brooks Roofing, the protection you need when Mother Nature strikes. BrooksRoofingIN.com. They're probably working in your neighborhood right now. Get those roofs taken care of before the wintertime. And, of course, Bubba's 33 is bringing us a free lunch Friday. Giving away a calendar. May have to do a couple. Calendars and appetizers today. How's that sound? May do three.
I like it.
Go all out. Or maybe two. I don't know. See how I feel. Oh, Indiana, Ohio State, what are your thoughts on that coming up?
Can Indiana hang in?
Can they survive? I mean, what do you literally, the score. I think it is going to be like a 48-12, 48-14, 48, yeah. Something like that.
I think Trevor nailed it yesterday.
I do, too. And it's sad. Because you don't want to say same old, but that's the same old.
Yeah.
It is what it is.
If it's going to be the same old, then Indiana's going to be down probably 10-7 at some point in the first quarter. They'll be in it a little bit, 17-7, still in the second quarter.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. You gave them a score in the first quarter?
Yeah, it seems like when Indiana plays Ohio State, they always hang close in the first quarter.
Okay.
First quarter.
Everybody
half.
Keeps saying, talking about how well Indiana plays Ohio State, and I agree they have played them historically in the last few years. That was not this team. That is not this team. This team and this offensive coordinator and this quarterback. This is a whole different situation. I think they're going to get destroyed. I think they're going to have nothing for Ohio State. And I think they're going to not be able to stop them. The passing game is vertical. The running game is solid. Now, they're just a better team. That has nothing to do with nothing other than they're just better. But normally Indiana at least has an offense they can compete. Not so much. I'll be shocked.
I'd almost be willing to bet you that it's within 10.5.
Jump. Feeling squirrely, brother. Because I'll take that bet right now.
Let me ponder on that a little bit.
Yeah, you ponder on it because I'm taking that bet right now.
I don't think it's going to be close at the end, but I do think it. I think Indiana will be able to hang with them in the first half.
Okay, we'll just do the first half.
Maybe not 10. I might need 13.
Oh, come on. A half?
All right, I'll do 10. Come on, bring it.
All right, 10 it is. What are we betting?
Bubba's. Might as well.
Sure. Works for me. Love it. Love it. Going to be, oh, today's Joey Palooza. It's actually been going on all week. But I'll be at Bubba's today around 6 for Joey Palooza. But you can Google it all you want. You're not going to find it.
What is Joey Palooza?
I hear you. I hear your little fingers in there tapping away like a little mouse.
I'm trying to figure it out here.
Like a little rat and they're eating cheese. It's not in there. It's someone's birthday extravaganza.
Some guy named Joey?
Yeah. Boy, you're quick.
Been his birthday all week?
Pretty much.
One of those guys that celebrates his birthday for the month?
Pretty much. Well, I mean, hey, it's a good gig if you can get it. It's a good gig if you can get it. Sammy Jacobs is on the show today from Hoosier Huddle. We'll get everything set up for tomorrow's game with Indiana and Ohio State. That's a 4 p.m. kickoff from the Shoe in Columbus, Ohio. It's on Fox Sports. Or right here on Big X Sports Radio, you can hear Don Fisher, the voice of the Hoosiers. He'll be with us on Monday to talk about what I expect to be the debacle. Now, coming up next week, Indiana's playing Iowa, a game that I still see as winnable. And I'd rather talk about the Iowa game. I still see that Iowa game as winnable. Iowa's not Ohio State. Ohio State is just not winnable, period. I don't care who quarterbacks, I don't care who offensive coordinator is. Nobody, they're not winning this game against this team. They're too young, they don't have the personnel yet. Iowa, it's a different story. Iowa's not as strong. This offense, as limited as it is, if it's rolling, can be very effective if they can keep the quarterback upright. And that'll be the telltale sign against Iowa.
If you can't,
you can't win that game.
I think that Iowa game's big. Not only is it one of the games that Indiana could win, but Iowa's going to be a top 25 coming in, more than likely. But also that game smashed right between Ohio State and Penn State, two games that you're pretty much guaranteed to not win. So, yeah, I mean, this Iowa game is important. I mean, if you could find a way to win it, kind of brings back the fan base in a little bit.
Yeah, otherwise you're going to be on a three-game losing streak.
Four. Well, yeah, three, yeah.
But they will be 4-4 at that time, though.
Yeah.
They will have dropped to even. A little disheartening, but.
Especially when you're staring 8-4 right in the face.
Mm-hmm. But more importantly, because Iowa is one of the four teams that Indiana has a shot to beat. And Iowa is the team on the outside, the least likely for them to beat. But one of the four, and you don't want this coming down to the Purdue game. You do not want to go into Purdue sitting on a 5-6 record.
Doesn't that happen every year, seems like?
No, it happened last year. As a matter of fact,
happened in 2007 as well.
You definitely don't want to go into that game with both of you needing that win for a bowl game. That happened last year for the first time ever.
We saw how that worked out.
Not very well. It's going to be interesting. It's going to be interesting. What do you think? What do you think they're going to end up doing? You know, they're sitting at 4-1 right now. They've got four winnable games for sure. Could they win all of them? Who knows?
Does Indiana make a bowl, in your opinion?
Yes. I think they win two more games. If they stay healthy, I mean, they're insisting on using the Ramsey DeBoring pound the ball every 5 yards with a pass. Well, they've lost Luke Timian to injury because of that. They've lost Wop Villiar because of that. Now they're down to Jayshon Harris, who's their punt returner. What happens if he goes?
Don't even talk like that. I can't even see that kid get hurt one more time.
Well, no, but I'm just saying.
That would just be horrible.
And they spent the entire last second half of the Rutgers game in this protection mode, I guess, of Ramsey. You're going to do that the rest of the year? You got 7 games left.
Yeah.
You going to do that against Ohio State in the first half? So I don't know.
And it becomes an issue of why protect him? I mean, you've got a capable quarterback waiting in the wings.
They want to redshirt him. It doesn't make sense to me. This plan, conservatives, this plan not to lose stuff. Yeah, we'll see how it works out, but
normally doesn't.
We'll see if they've made changes. I think Tom Allen. I know he heard the. Not that he's motivated by what he hears, but I'm just saying. I'm sure he heard the noise.
Yeah, be hard not to.
I mean, he acknowledged something's got to be done with the offense. We'll see. We'll see how it turns out. We've got to take a break. We've got Sammy Jacobs on the show today, Drew Davis as well. This is an all-you show. Make sure you hit us up on the text line. Questions, comments. Want to talk about the FBI college basketball corruption trial that is engaged and going on. Brian Bowen Sr. gave testimony yesterday. We'll talk about it. Indiana Sports Beats coming right back.
If you're a homeowner and have storm damage to your roof, you want a hometown contractor you can count on and trust. Brooks Roofing of New Albany has been doing quality work since 2006. Check out their work for yourself at brooksroofingin.com. No job is too big or too small, commercial or residential. Brooks Roofing is probably working in your neighborhood right now. Visit brooksroofingin.com or call 812-868-ROOF. That's 812-868-ROOF. Brooks Roofing, the protection you need when nature strikes.
This hour of Indiana Sports Beat is brought to you by Kentuckiana's Premier Truck Center. With locations in Louisville and Clarksville, sales or service, they've got you covered. Kentuckiana's Premier Truck Center.
We've got a long way to go and a short time to get there.
Welcome back to Indiana Sports Beat here on this Friday. TGIF. Free lunch Friday from Bubba's 33 as well. With an Indiana poster. I wonder if we should wait or give one away this hour.
We can.
For the early risers.
We don't have many of those.
I understand. Sometimes you don't have them in the studio.
Sure.
But I don't mind giving one away this hour.
Go for it.
I have to think of something here. But see, they have to respond on the text line, which it's hard to do at 6 o'clock in the morning.
May have forgot the number. 502-414-1450.
Think of a question.
All right.
But Indiana taking on Ohio State this weekend. A game I don't expect to be very fun. There's been Columbus at the Shoe. There will be about 105,000 people there. It's a raucous environment, one of the great places in college football, one of the largest stadiums in college football. You know, I think Beaver Stadium in Pennsylvania is, I thought they were like third behind Ohio State and Michigan, which Michigan being the biggest. They had 110,000 the other day at that Penn State-Ohio State game.
Yeah, I heard that too.
The time I was at the big house, they had 110,000. It's a city, man. It's a city.
Yeah, Michigan, officially Michigan is number one, then Penn State, Beaver Stadium, then Ohio State.
Okay. What's Ohio State, like 102?
It says almost 105. 104,944.
A lot of people.
And then the next four in the list are SEC schools.
Tennessee's up there.
Yep.
What are the other big ones in the SEC?
LSU, Alabama. Georgia's actually number 10 at 92,000.
Do any of the SEC schools hold 100,000?
Yes, Texas A&M and Tennessee and LSU and Alabama actually all hold 100,000.
They've increased.
Yeah. And Texas holds 100,000 as well. Those are the eight stadiums that hold 100,000.
I didn't know Texas A&M held 100.
Yeah.
Wow.
They're fourth on the list. Almost
really?
Almost 103.
Wow, so they've really expanded. What's Texas?
Number eight, 100,000. Right, just over it.
I'm sure it makes them proud that they have a bigger stadium than Texas. A&M.
No, A&M has the bigger stadium.
No, that's what I'm saying. I'm sure that makes A&M happy that they have a bigger stadium than their rival Texas over in Austin.
Iowa actually rounds out this top 25 list of biggest stadiums.
Iowa?
Yeah, 70,500.
Oh, that's...
Goes down quick.
That's tiddlywinks. But how about we get the Yankees and the Red Sox?
Love it.
First time in 14 years in a playoff series.
It's been that long since they played in a playoff series?
The big epic comeback. Red Sox were down 3-0 against the New York Yankees, and unbelievably, they come back to win that series 4-3. I was watching some highlights last night in the game four. Not only they were losing and close, like close to the game being over when they come back and won that game, which would start one of the most epic comebacks in all of sports because that may be the biggest, greatest rivalry in all of sports, New York Yankees and the Boston Red Sox.
And it may be the only time that a team was down 3-0 in a best-of-seven series and won. Not 100% on that, but I want to say it's the only time it's ever happened in baseball for sure.
Not true.
Not true.
Not true. I think it may have been the first time someone came back from a 3-game deficit.
That's what I said.
It's happened.
That's sad.
But it's happened. It's happened since, for sure, but I think that's not the only time. I'm virtually certain of that. But looking forward to that series getting uncorked. What are you thinking about this weekend, sports-wise? 502-414-1450. Hit us up on the text line. What do you think about the Indiana-Ohio State game? What are your thoughts there?
Huh. There have been 34 times that a baseball team has been down 0-3 in a best-of-seven postseason series. One of those teams came back to win. Love it when I'm right. Doesn't happen often. Yeah, it was the Red Sox.
Well, of course it was the Red Sox since we're talking about that.
Yeah. Well, I knew that. 2004.
Yeah, that'd be 14 years ago. Magically. Remember 14 years ago since the series?
Well, I mean, yeah, I know I can do the math. I don't know how I'm supposed to remember it. You're looking at me like I'm supposed to ring a bell of some sort.
Indiana taking on Ohio State this weekend. Pat Peyton Ramsey leading the offense. What can they get done? Seriously, can they come out of there injury free? Right now, they're kind of hit with the injuries on the receiving core. Luke Timian, Wapfillyard, both out. And there's no point to bring them back for this game, even if they're close. Doesn't matter. You don't need them. This is not a winnable game. Just, you hate to say it, but it's not a winnable game.
If they come out healthy, is that a win?
Yeah. If you don't embarrass yourself, it's a win. You will have gotten some valuable experience. But, yeah, they got to get through this game unscathed. Because if they're in the protect Peyton Ramsey mode, that's a dangerous mode to be in. We'll see how it works out.
Just give us a game in the first quarter. That's all I ask.
You think Indiana scores in the first quarter?
I think they score in the first half. I think they score in the first quarter. Yeah.
Well, I'm glad we have that bet. 10 points at halftime.
Yeah, that might have been a little ridiculous, but I'll back it. I'll stick with it.
I'm glad you are. Now I'm going to tell you what I think it's going to be. I think it's going to be 3 touchdowns by halftime.
Oof. Unwatchable in the second half.
Nah. I was watching the Rutgers game last night. Rewatch those. 26-point underdog now, Indiana is.
It's going up.
Last night, Houston and Tulsa played. Houston knocked off Tulsa 41-26. What are your thoughts on the Brian Bowen testimony? Have you seen any of it? Have you read any of that?
Yeah.
Did you?
Pretty telling, all things considered. I mean, it's not only was Brian Bowen getting paid to go to college, but he was getting paid to go to La Lumiere. He was getting paid to play at AAU ball. That's just mind-blowing, the fact that these guys are getting paid at every level of basketball.
They were certainly finding a way to pull in the money. Well, $2,000 a month while he went to La Lumiere.
Yeah.
While his son was going to La Lumiere. Who's paying for that, I wonder?
Right.
Where does that money come from? Adidas? I'm asking.
Yeah.
Even from like La Lumiere, is that money coming from Adidas?
I wouldn't imagine so. I mean, with La Lu, I would imagine it's probably just coming from in-house. I mean, you're charging, I can't even imagine what the tuition probably is for La Lu, but I mean, when you're charging kids that much in tuition, you can spare an extra $2,000 a month. But I mean, at the same time, it very well could have came from Adidas.
Well, it has to come from somewhere. That's $24,000 a year.
Yeah.
That he's getting. Plus, he's pulling money in from the AAU circuit or whatever. And he's making a nice little living.
Yeah. He was getting checks for consulting fees, but he had never done any consulting work for the shoe companies.
Well, that was how they were paying
him. Right.
That was just what they were listing him as.
Yeah.
But he was on the stand yesterday, and Brian Bowen, they asked him if he was presently in college. And he said, no, he's not. And I said, why is he not in college? And at that point, he was overcome with emotion, and they had to take a 20-minute break. But he's not in college because his father was greedy and took money. And he never got to play a minute in college.
And he blamed all the coaches for that.
Yeah, conveniently. Yeah, shortly after he returned to the stand, about 20 minutes later, it wasn't long before he'd accused a handful of colleges, including Arizona, Creighton, Oklahoma State, Texas, of offering him tens of thousands of dollars in cash and other improper benefits for his son to play basketball at those schools.
Here's my thing, though. If Bowen Sr. feels bad about this now,
He doesn't feel bad about it. He's doing it because he gets immunity from prosecution. Yeah. He's a criminal.
Maybe feel bad about it wasn't the right word. But you couldn't think at this in the moment that this was maybe against the rules?
Of course he did. He didn't care. He was taking the money.
And now you want to sit up there and blame these colleges when you were an active part in it as well. That seems wrong to me.
You understand how this game's played, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
He's doing this because he's getting out of being prosecuted.
Right.
So he has to give them what they want. It's a simple game is all this is. He doesn't feel bad.
Right.
Adidas executive James Gatto and former Adidas consultant Merle Code also were defendants in the case, along with Dawkins. They're accused of conspiring to influence players to sign with Adidas-sponsored schools like Kansas, Louisville, Miami, North Carolina State. Each of the three men has pleaded not guilty. According to Bowen Sr., Dawkins told him that assistant coach Joe Pasternak offered $50,000. Oklahoma State assistant Lamont Evans apparently offered $150,000 cash, $8,000 for a car, and additional money to buy a house.
Be hard to turn that down.
Texas assistant Mike Morrow offered to help me with housing, according to Bowen Sr. And Creighton assistant coach Preston Murphy offered $100,000 and a good job, a lucrative job. Now, how the hell does Creighton, if they have the ability to buy players for $100,000, why the hell do they suck so bad?
That's what I'm sitting here thinking. Creighton, out of all schools, Creighton.
All these schools, they suck. They got money like this to toss around by players, and they still suck? You need to get caught. But Pasternak is now the head coach at UC Santa Barbara. Evans is one of three former assistant coaches who are charged in a separate federal case. It's accused of accepting bribes from Dawkins and others to influence players to sign with certain agents and financial advisors. Morrill is now the head coach at UNC Asheville. Murphy, a Saginaw, Michigan native, is still employed at Creighton. How is this going to shake out? These people are being lambasted here, accused of offering payment to play, and they're coaches right now. The coaches from Louisville, Kenny Johnson, he's got a job somewhere. Jordan Fair, he's got a job somewhere, and it was told that they both gave money. Both of them.
Will they have jobs when this is all said and done is the question.
That's the $64,000 question, but I can't imagine. The NCAA's not gotten involved yet. They've been told to stand down by the FBI until this is over. A spokesman for Texas declined to answer questions at this time. Arizona officials have yet to respond to messages left by ESPN requesting a response to that. Oklahoma State said it would not comment until the inquiry is complete. University of California Santa Barbara athletic spokesman Bill Mahoney said school officials were not aware of statements made in court regarding Pasternak prior to Thursday, and they have not been contacted by federal investigators involved in the trial. Regarding Oregon, another school, defense attorney said in opening statements had offered an astronomical amount of money for Bowen. Bowen Sr. said, I don't recall that. Huh. So they get off. They got a break.
Yeah.
Bowen Sr. said he talked to a couple of the coaches during his son's recruitment, but not about the financial offers, which are a violation of NCAA rules. Which he's not saying that. They're just saying that. Bowen's a former Saginaw police officer. He appeared in court after the government offered him a non-prosecutorial agreement in exchange for his testimony. You want to hear what he got?
Let's hear it.
$2,000 a month from Shane Heyman for Bowen to attend La Lemire in LaPorte. He was the head coach of La Lemire at the time. He's now an assistant at DePaul. There's another one.
And he was directly giving the money as the head coach.
Yep. Dawkins Dorian Pride AAU team He's where he was playing. He moved to the Michigan Mustangs on the Adidas circuit after Adidas program director T.J. Gasnola offered Bowen Sr. $25,000 for his son to play for the Mustangs.
Family never had to work.
Gasnola, youth basketball director for Massachusetts, pleaded guilty to one and made a one count of felony count of wire fraud conspiracy. He agreed to cooperate with prosecutors. He's testifying next week. See, all the guys that agreed to testify now are testifying. All the dirt's coming out, baby. We'll talk about it a little bit more when we come back. We've got to take a quick break. Sammy Jacobs is on the show today, as is Drew Davis. Let us know what you're thinking. 502-414-1450. Hit us up on the text line. Indiana Sports Beat coming right back. This is Jim Coyle. When I'm not on the road covering the Hoosiers, you can find me at Bubba's 33 on the northeast side of I-65 at Veterans Parkway in Clarksville. Bring the team in for that post-win meal in the family dining area or just meet friends for a happy hour. Bubba's has bold burgers, hand-tossed pizzas, mouth-watering wings, and a list of select local craft brewers for the coldest beer in town. Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Burgers, pizza, beer. Today's guest is brought to you by Brooks Roofing, the protection you need when Mother Nature strikes. BrooksRoofingIN.com. Indiana Sports Beat, Jim Coyle sitting in with you. Hope your day is going well and week has been great as well. Weekend is here. TGIF. Drew Davis from Peaks.com is with us now. Drew, how are you, sir?
Oh, I'm doing good, man. It's Friday, so I couldn't be better.
It is. A lot going on in the federal college basketball corruption trial in New York. Brian Bowen Sr. on the stand yesterday talking about a lot of things, even receiving money for Bowen going to Lala Muir.
I haven't had a chance to break down the whole thing because it seemed like Bowen was pointing a lot of fingers and mentioning a lot of different things. So I had a chance to go through a little bit of it, but I guess the thing that kind of bothers me about this whole thing is it's almost like people are overlooking the fact that Brian Bowen Sr. It's like they're overlooking the fact of his role in the situation. To me, Brian Bowen Sr. is very much part of the problem. He was the one going around asking for money, you know, and that now he's pointing fingers.
Yeah, he is, but here's the thing. If he's not talking, then nobody knows how it actually happens. Then nobody knows how it works. No one knows that Lala Muir was paying them $2,000 a month for Bowen to go to school there. And I think he got money from the AAU, and then he named all these coaches that were offering money. But if they don't name these things, then they're not found out and it's not stopped. But yeah, I agree. He is, and people like him are part of the problem. And to put it in a better perspective, he was asked early on in his testimony if Brian Bowen Jr., if he was in college right now. And he said no. And then when they asked him why, he broke down and they had to take a 20-minute break. But knowing because his greed is why his son is not in college. Is why his son can never play college. It's his greed that caused that.
Right.
So I agree with you in every aspect of what you're saying. But on the other side of the coin, if these guys don't come forward and talk, then they don't know how things are done, who's doing it, and all that.
Right. And at the end of the day, the real victim in this whole situation is Brian Bowen Jr. He's the one that, you know, went to the went to South Carolina after Louisville and the NCAA said he was, you know, not going to have any eligibility left. And then Brian went to the combine and he wasn't, you know, ready to compete at that level. And now he's playing overseas in the Australian League because of the whole situation that happened. And it's just sad for Bowen Jr. that, you know, at the end of the day, this has a big effect on his career, his development as a basketball player, and where he can go and whatnot. And And at the end of the day, if Brian Bowen Jr. doesn't pan out, he's going to sit back and think a large reason that could be was because, you know, his path to the NBA was drastically changed by his dad's actions. And, you know, I think it's just a really sad story and sad how Brian Bowen Jr. ended up, you know, in the Australian League right now.
Absolutely. You're absolutely correct. And it is another story. It just reminds me of the Balls, how that idiot father got involved. And you've got a kid that maybe he didn't have a chance to play college basketball. He wasn't going to be good enough. But the youngest one did, but not going to be playing college basketball either. And I hate to see people taking that away from kids. And it's a shame to see them not get to have those opportunities.
Right, right. And I guess there is one thing that's, you know, about the Balls, at least it was a little bit more by their, you know, own choice than, you know, Brian Bowen Jr. kind of just getting, you know, so to speak, hit in the face by all this stuff last year. And, you know, when it pops up, and it's just, you know, I think people forget that it's really hard to be a pro. It takes some time to develop, and, you know, playing overseas isn't a bed of roses. So what he's going through right now, is it the easiest, you know, a pass? And that journey's not for everyone. You have to have a special mindset. You have to have a special drive to go overseas and make it to the pros. And hopefully it works out for Bowen Jr., because at the end of the day, the reason he's in this situation really isn't his fault, to be honest.
Exactly, and he is the victim, as you pointed out, and it's a shame that he does not get to do that. And it's going to be, but it will affect his career. He would be a better player if he was in college. He'd get to be at home. Now he's living overseas. He's a kid. He's 18, 19 years old. And he's being forced to do this stuff because of a parent's greed, of an adult's greed, period. So just another point of adults meddling in the lives of kids. And this mess that is college basketball, so we'll see what more is going to come out. There's more people that are going to be testifying that have immunity as well. Several of the coaches were mentioned. The Louisville coaches were mentioned to have provided money. A lot of coaches named, a lot of programs named. And the NCAA has not even begun to do anything yet because the FBI has told them to stand down. So there's going to be a great deal of fallout from this.
I guess the thing that I was, you know, finding interesting, and my whole question is, you know, just because School A offered Brian Bowen, you know, for example, would have said $50K for the heck of it, you know, just because the school offered him, you know, to say $50K, and that doesn't mean, you know, they're necessarily on the hook as much as a school that, you know, actually did offer him something. Because at the end of the day, you know, regardless of a school said that, they still have to follow through with it for them to be, you know, for them to, you know, make a violation. They have to follow through with it. And it, you know, all the schools that are mentioned, I'm interested to see how is the NCAA going to be going about this, because, you know, they're mentioned, but at the end of the day, the money has to, you know, change hands for them to, you know, have committed a violation.
And there was some mention of Romeo Langford in the opening statements when they were in the jury selection. They were told that there would be a number of schools mentioned, people, names mentioned, and his was one of those. It didn't say why. It's unclear at this point what landed him there. But it's probably more than likely to do with the topics covered in the story in the Washington Post in May with Will. What was it, Will Greer? He was on the program. But about his relationship between Langford Adidas and Langford's family. But we don't know that. But there's been no suggestion that there's anything to worry about whatsoever. To my knowledge, there's absolutely not.
Right, right. I think that's more of an association thing. The same as like Zion Williamson or, you know, somebody like Clint Grimes. I think it's mainly because Romeo was recruited by Kansas and Louisville at one point, and they're both been mentioned in the probe. And I think that Washington Post article, like you mentioned, has something to do with it. There's no real, you know, so far no real evidence or anything that suggests that this is anything more than just, you know, an association mention, and I don't really expect much to come of this, to be honest. I think that they're basically just, you know, putting out, you know, a PSA basically saying, hey, this name may come up, but, you know, don't, you know, automatically just, you know, freak out about it, because they're basically saying a lot of names are going to come up, but that doesn't mean there's going to be any guilt or anything.
Absolutely. So moving forward, there's got to be a lot of nervous coaches out there, man, that know that their name could be brought up. Louisville, the only program that has basically cleaned house, firing their athletics director and their head basketball coach, and he's not really named in any. He's not been named in any charges, Patino. So it's a very interesting story that's unfolding.
Yeah, it's very interesting from a number of angles. You know, you sit back there and you kind of see some of the programs that are mentioned. If things are true, you know, it could change kind of the landscape of college basketball, because you look at a program that's being thrown around in here, like, you know, Kansas and Louisville of the world. Those are huge programs, man. And at the end of the day, if something does happen, that's a big program that's, you know, obviously going to be changed and going to be different. You know, if something does come out and to have a big impact on Indiana's, you know, recruiting in the Midwest, especially of a school like, you know, Kansas, is no longer, you know, that Kansas that we've grown accustomed to. That can really change things up in the Midwest and really open the door for, you know, one of these, you know, young coaches like a Chris Holtman and an Archinola or a Chris Mack to really, you know, put their fingerprint on the Midwest and really kind of, you know, become the guy in that region.
Talking with Drew Davis and Pigs.com. What about Lala Muir's former head coach, who Bowen Sr. said gave him $2,000 a month for his son to play there? He's now an assistant at DePaul. That's got to be something that they have to seriously look at. And he's not the only coach that has been named to have offered money that is currently coaching.
I hadn't really seen that whole situation yet. I'd seen one of the colleges had offered, but I would say that would be something they would look into more, like you said, because their coach is currently a college assistant coach. So I'd say that'd be something they'd look into a little more than, say, just your typical, you know, high school coach. But it'll be interesting, you know, if that figure's correct, to see. It'll be interesting to see how much of an issue the NCAA or anyone makes of that, because, you know, if you look at the grand scheme of things compared to the money that's been mentioned with Bowen that's changed hands, that doesn't really seem like too much. So it'll be interesting to see. Does the NCAA pick certain battles here? You know, do they look at the big stuff, or do they break everything down and go after everything? You know what I'm saying?
Looking forward to seeing how it shakes out, Drew. I appreciate you joining us as always. I hope you got a great weekend planned. What's going on in the world of recruiting for Indiana?
Well, it's not necessarily, you know, Indiana like related, but Trace Jackson Davis, he'll be at Michigan State this weekend for his final official visit. Decision expected sometime, you know, in the next couple of weeks. And then you'll have Keon Brooks Jr. He will not be making any visits this weekend. He's going to be out in Colorado Springs for the USA Basketball minicamp. Some other IU targets that are out there will be Caleb Love. I think Kamari Lance or Ron Lumiere. He was a younger guy that received an invite, so it'll be interesting to see what's going on out there, because that's always an event that I thought has gone pretty well, and I think the guys will compete out there. So I look forward to seeing how those guys do out there. And really for IU, it's not too busy of a weekend recruiting wise, but some guys that are their, you know, targets are kind of going through the process right now.
Has Keon already visited Michigan State with an official visit?
No, he has not. He has not set a date for that. I know he was looking at between Purdue and Michigan State for an official visit. And to me, it was kind of interesting that he hasn't set a date yet, but we'll see what happens. I don't expect Keon to go through this process and not give Michigan State a visit. To me, that would be a shocker because just the way Keon has talked about Michigan State and the way Michigan State's been recruiting him for the longest. To me, if he didn't visit Michigan State, I'd be very surprised.
Trey Saxon-Davis is up at Michigan State this weekend, like you said. How soon after this visit do you think a commitment can come?
I'd probably say within the next two, three, 4 weeks. Look for Trace to make a decision. I mean, he could obviously do a list cut or something, which he's talked about cutting it down to two, which could slow it down a little bit. But
what's the point of that? I mean, at this stage, what's the point of paring it down more? It doesn't really matter. Just pick the one and go with that instead of paring it from four to three to two to one. Just do it.
Yeah, you know, some guys, they just like to be recruited, and, you know, you never know if he wants to just pick the two front runners and go, you know, pros and cons for schools A and B. I mean, you never know, but I thought it was interesting to see him cut it down, or to mention the idea of cutting it down to two schools. I thought that was just kind of interesting, to be honest.
It will be. Certainly appreciate you joining us, Drew, every week here on the program. Look forward to it. We'll talk to you soon.
All right, man. Take it easy and have a good weekend.
Thank you. Drew Davis from Peaks.com. Check him out there. Brought to you by Brooks Roofing, the protection you need when Mother Nature strikes. BrooksRoofingIN.com. They're probably working in your neighborhood right now. Local contractor, been doing business here since 2006. Reach out to Brooks Roofing at BrooksRoofingIN.com. Indiana Sports Beats coming back with more. Sammy Jacobs will be on the program yet. We'll talk more about the corruption trial here on Indiana Sports Beat. Coming right back.
If you want to get your day off to a good start, then stop at Billy Joe's Gas and Food Mart on Highway 150 in Floyd's Knot. While you're filling your gas tank, you could fill your own tank with a hot breakfast or try one of Billy Joe's daily lunch specials. Billy Joe's Gas and Food Mart opens at 5 a.m. and everything is made fresh daily. And if you bring your own mug, coffee is only 50 cents. And Billy Joe's also has free air. The best place to start your day is at Billy Joe's Gas and Food Mart on Highway 150 in Floyd's Knot.
This hour of Indiana Sports Beat is brought to you by Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. With hand-tossed pizzas, bold burgers, and ice-cold beer. Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Pizza, burgers, beer.
Darling, you got to let me know.
Welcome back to Indiana Sports Beat here on Big X Sports Radio. On this Friday, TGIF Friday, free lunch Friday from Bubba's. Gonna give it away. Got it. IU basketball calendar.
I got a question.
Do you?
I do.
What is it?
It's fairly easy.
Okay.
Where is Brian Bowen playing professional basketball right now?
Ooh. There you go. All right, folks, you heard it. Hit it up on the text line. First one in gets a free appetizer and a basketball calendar from Bubba's.
502-414-1450 is that number.
You have to be able to pick it up at Bubba's. Because that's where to be.
Well, you've got to go there anyways to redeem it, so.
Well, yeah, I'm just saying. That's where you get the calendar and your coupon.
Got to get people in the door to get them their prize.
Well, don't spill.
Don't.
It's like you're like a magician showing the tricks.
Don't ruin the game plan.
Yeah. But hit it up, yeah. 502-414-1450. Hit up on the text line. Find out who we can give that away to. But we've got some IU basketball calendars and some food from Bubba's, so looking forward to that. Where is Brian Bowen playing professional basketball? There you go. There's your question. Easy to hit up on Google, I'm sure. Knock it out.
Or just go to the FBI probe.
Hey, make sure you like and follow us on Facebook. You can find the show each and every day, our podcast rebroadcast on iTunes, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Google Play, and IndianaSportsBeat.com, where you can Never miss a beat with Indiana Sports Beat. Keep you covered. Also, guess where I'm going when we get out of here?
Where are you going?
Oh, my goodness. I'm going to see our good friends at Reynolds Family Dentistry in Sellersburg.
Come on.
You know, for over 30 years, Reynolds Family Dentistry has been taking care of Southern Indiana's dental needs. Let Drs. Roger and Jay Reynolds take care of your family, both IU grads. I'll be seeing them soon. I've got a dental appointment this morning.
They're going to leave you with a smile for them championship photos.
Exactly. I'm looking so forward to it. I have been there before. It's an enjoyable experience. So a lot of people fear going to the dentist. It was comfortable. It was very comfortable. It's so comfortable there. So we're cool with that. All lower. Indiana, Ohio State on Saturday. What are your thoughts on that? Hit us up on the text line, 502-414-1450. The point spread is currently at 26. It went up a point, which is barely moving. Why do they even move at a point when it's that much? That's an odd number.
25. They don't move it. The people move it.
The people.
People who are betting on it.
The people. And 25, that's an odd number.
That is an odd number.
You know, we were talking about Brian Bowen Sr. in the last segment, getting paid in every which direction for his son, man. He's made a living off of his son so far. And the funny thing is, the real money, the NBA, he's derailed him for a trip to the NBA by screwing up his college eligibility, not being able to play in college where he could have learned a lot and been here in America. But now he's overseas playing basketball because you can't play in the NBA until you're 19 right now. And so he's got to do something for this year. Make some money instead of what wasted year. Of course. Go ahead.
Speaking of overseas, Tim T got the question right.
He's the man with the plan.
He said Sydney Kings originally, which is the team. So I made him clarify where that was at. He got it. Australia.
I'll have to send that in here in a second. I'll remember to do that. We'll do it again the next hour, later on this hour. We'll give it away more. We'll give away more in the final segment. How's that? But congratulations, Tim T. Yeah, hit us up on the text line, 502-414-1450. Let us know, what are your thoughts on the IU Ohio State game? What are your thoughts on this college basketball corruption trial that's going on? Brian Bowen Sr., naming all these guys. We're finding out who's doing what, who's offering, who's paying. What's going to happen to them next? That's the question. I mean, he names even right down to the former coach at Lala Muir Academy, who is now an assistant at DePaul. But apparently he was paying him $2,000 a month just for Brian Bowen Jr. to go to school there. What happens with him? The NCAA they've been sitting on the sidelines per the request of the FBI, which I'm sure they greatly enjoy sitting on the sidelines because it means they don't have to do anything. And this is going to be great for them because they're going to take mostly what the FBI has done and run with it, and then they'll screw it up somehow.
Yeah.
It'll take them 16 years to go through an investigation, and then it'll be found that, no, North Carolina's not guilty. It's okay to have fake classes.
One thing from this whole report that really kind of left me awestruck, maybe not awestruck, but Rick Pitino, if you remember back when they got Brian Bowen, he said, I've never even heard of this kid. Like, that, it was such a surprise, came out of left field. Well, then it came out yesterday that James Gatto, the Adidas executive, was in contact with Rick Pitino not once but twice before Bowen even committed. The second time he left a voicemail and said, this is Coach Gatto, hope all is well, checking in. I heard the good news, and it's going to be good, and I'm excited for you guys.
Yeah, I don't think he's ever said he had never heard of him. They hadn't been recruiting him.
I don't know about that.
I'm pretty positive. They hadn't been recruiting him, and they said, and they hadn't.
Louisville actually offered Bowen a scholarship when he was a freshman in high school.
Right.
But then they didn't contact him much after that.
So it wouldn't be smart for him to say he's never heard of him. But which I don't think that was the case. But they were not actively recruiting him. And I've not seen anything that showed Louisville was going after him. I see Adidas pimping him out.
Good way to put it.
That's what happened to Kansas, apparently, allegedly. Kansas didn't get in trouble because they were victimized. Because Adidas did the same thing to them. What if it turns out that's exactly what happened to Louisville? Rick Pitino had no knowledge. Does that change your thoughts about him?
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, his assistants were obviously dirty as hell. They both have been shown to have given money, although not a lot, but money. Kenny Johnson and Jordan Fair both had been let go by Louisville. Jordan Fair was in a hotel room with the FBI, caught on a wire.
Wiretap.
But none of them charged. Notice that? Both of them are, well, at least Kenny Johnson's coaching for, what, Lamar?
LaSalle.
So, again, what happens with him?
Does the Kenny Johnson name worry you at all from an Indiana aspect?
No, because that's so far long ago. I don't think this stuff was going on then. I mean, it was going on, but I don't think that he was quite involved in the train. But, and the only thing that I've seen that he did, he gave like $1,200 to somebody. But that was to do with Bowen, wasn't it?
$1,300, yeah.
Who did he give that to?
Just a second.
Bowen's dad? I mean, he seems to be the guy who got everything.
Yeah, Bowen Sr.
When was that? What was that for?
Who knows? Doesn't say in this article.
And where'd the money come from? Did Pitino know about the money? He may not have. If that came from Adidas, they may have very well kept him in the dark about it. Now, that does not mean that he's innocent. He hired Jordan Fair. He hired Kenny McGee, or McGee.
Andre
McGee. He's hired all these clowns. He hired Kenny Johnson. He hired these people. He hired Jordan Fair after already having been on double secret probation. So he shouldn't have been doing any hiring, to be honest with you.
Tim T texts in and says, I know some parents were wrong, but I think Adidas should be accountable for these kids' careers being messed up and should have to pay for career damages.
I agree.
Not a bad idea.
Nope. Maybe there are lawsuits going on. There will probably be more. That's another thing that could come out of this. But if these guys have immunity from prosecution, you going to be able to sue them?
Great question.
It's a whole bunch of stuff going on, man. What are your thoughts? Hit us up on the text line, 502-414-1450. We got to take a break. When we come back, Sammy Jacobs from Hoosier Huddle, he's going to be on. We'll set the stage for Indiana and Ohio State tomorrow. Right back here on Indiana Sports Beat.
We all want a winning smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you will get at Reynolds Family Dentistry in Sellersburg. Reynolds Family Dentistry has been serving the dental needs of Hoosier families for over 30 years. Let Drs. Roger and Jay Reynolds take care of your family. Just off of I-65 at 809 South Indiana Avenue in Sellersburg. Call 812-246-3368. That's Reynolds Family Dentistry, 812-246-3368.
Today's guest is brought to you by Kentuckiana's Premier Truck Center, located 5 miles north of downtown Louisville, just off of I-65 at Veterans Parkway in Clarksville. Welcome back to Indiana Sports Beats here on this Friday. Hope you've got a big weekend planned. I'm ready for it. Joined now by Sammy Jacobs from Hoosier Huddle. Sammy, how are you, my friend?
Good morning, Jim. I'm doing great. How are you?
Good, sir. You had a good start to the week, at least. Saw you were at Wrigley Field for the Cubs' short run in the playoffs this season.
It was a long, short run, 13 innings and 4 hours and 45 minutes. I didn't get home until 5 a.m. on, Wednesday morning.
Wow. Wow, big game. Unfortunately, the Cubs go down, but it had to be a fun night, a fun atmosphere at least.
It was fun. I'm a Yankees fan, just being from New York, growing up a Yankees fan, but fiance's family is all Cubs fans. They needed somebody to go, so I'm always up for a sporting event, so I went. It was awesome. We sat in the bleachers, and it was pretty cool up until they lost, and then you're like, oh God, we're going to be home at 5. So it was a lot of fun.
I couldn't believe when they had the bases juiced there in the latter part of the stages of the game, and they needed a left-handed batter to come up. Kyle Schwarber's ready to go, and I'm like, what? They don't bring Schwarber in. Couldn't believe it.
Yeah, well, Hayward's had a decent year, too, and you can't say that Schwarber wouldn't get a hit there, but he pinch hit later in the game and didn't get a hit. The offense didn't do much. You're not going to win a game, a lot of games scoring just one run.
Sammy Jacobs from Hoosier Huddle. We've got football tomorrow against Ohio State, Indiana. Last week, a win is a win, but a win's very improbable this week. What does IU need to get from this game?
They need to get out of this game healthy. This is, and put their head on straight, too. You can't go in there and lose 70-3. Or something embarrassing like that. Maybe, you can't have what happened against Wisconsin from 2010, where you went up there and you lost 83-20 or something like that. You can't get embarrassed. But I think the biggest thing is your health. You don't want to go in there and lose a couple key guys and have it wreck the rest of your season. October is a very, very tough month for IU. This is why September was so important to get 4 wins, is because you turn around in October, you have Ohio State, Iowa at home, Penn State, and then a short week against Minnesota.
And then you talked about coming out healthy. They kind of go into a protection mode with Ramsey in the second half against Rutgers, and what's the offense basically shut down. But they can't do that. They've got 7 games left. You can't handle those guys like they're China dolls and get through a season. And especially this week with Ohio State, they're going to be tested start to finish, front to back.
Yeah, and it's hard to say they protect Ramsey because he's still running draws and stuff like that in the second half. But it's one of those things, is do you expose guys to hits if you're down by, 4 or 5 scores late in the game? And, Ohio State's looking to go to the college football playoff, and the Big Ten's kind of down in people's eyes this year, so they need to put up style points as well. So we'll see. But you can't, you're not going to be, running naked bootlegs and things like that if you're down by, 4 or 5 scores. That's just irresponsible to the players, and their health, but you can't also, wrap them in bubble wrap and just take a knee the entire game. It's football. You're going to get hit, and you just hope that the guys bounce right back up.
With this offense, the guys that are getting most of the action have been Luke Timian and then Walt Filliar. They're just those short-range passes, both out with injuries, and they've turned to Jashaun Harris now. But if they continue to just run this type of offense, and these guys are getting pounded, how in the world are they going to get through 7 more games like that?
Well, I would assume that WAP and Luke Timian, if they're not 100%, are going to sit out. And I'm not really sure what Timian's injury was. He had a sleeve on his leg against Michigan State, and I didn't see him last week, or I don't recall seeing him last week on the sideline. Wop looked like he just turned an ankle at the bottom of a pile. It's hard to prevent that, you know, when you're getting tackled. But, you know, sending these guys across the middle to get crushed is a tall task for them. And, you know, maybe you got to look at the offense and say, hey, we got to either, you know, lean into the hit a little bit better and take it a little bit better or improve your throwing game to where you're not just hanging them out to dry to get crushed.
Indiana is currently 4-1, and the seven games they have left, three of them are definitely winnable, and one of them is definitely probably in that category, the Iowa game. But the other three being Purdue, Minnesota, and Maryland. Those three teams, Purdue and Maryland specifically, started the season out kind of rough, but Purdue seems to be getting the ship righted. Maryland seems to have gotten the ship righted. These guys are improving week after week. Is Indiana proving enough and keeping up with them?
Well, to go back on those guys first, I mean, Maryland looked great the first week and then laid an egg against Texas. So they've all had their, you know, steps back. Purdue looked pretty decent against Northwestern. Now, who knows what Northwestern is going to be the rest of the way. They sure as heck might struggle to get bowl eligible. As well, but they lost to a MAC team, and then Purdue went in and lost to Eastern Michigan and played pretty well since then. But you'll find out what those teams are in the next couple weeks. Maryland's got Michigan this week. Purdue's got, you know, Ohio State and Michigan State coming up in the next few weeks after a trip to Illinois. So we'll see. But I think Indiana, they haven't regressed, but they also haven't progressed as well as you'd want them to on offense. On defense, you could definitely tell that they've gotten better each week. You know, from that FIU game when everybody was freaking out, how can they give up 28 points to this team? The run game was getting gashed. The pass game was getting gashed. But now, you know, they forced 10 takeaways. They have one of the better pass defense in the Big Ten. Their running defense is better. It's still not where it needs to be, but it's better. And, you know, but offensively, it really hasn't changed that much from week one to week six.
And that has to be a concern, I mean, going forward. Again, that's with the easiest part of the schedule being played. And now I saw yesterday, Indiana has the second toughest remaining schedule in the country by one source.
Well, I hate saying that, you know, the Yankees had an easier schedule down the stretch in the second half than the Red Sox, and that really didn't mean that much this year. So the whole strength of schedule, I don't buy into that. You know, Minnesota's lost a couple guys to injury, and there's a three-star lineman who left yesterday as well. Guys go down. It's college football. In terms of that, you've played six games. You don't really know what these teams are still. And, you know, if one guy goes down and changes the dynamic of the whole team, sure, are they playing easier teams? Maybe. We'll see, or harder teams. They're definitely, you know, you got Ohio State and Michigan coming up here, and we'll see. But I don't buy into that strength of schedule in the second half to the first half stuff as much.
Not a lot of big games coming up in conference this weekend. The bigger games, of course, are probably over in the SEC, places like that. What are some of your favorite games that are coming up on the schedule this weekend?
Oh, well, you get the Red River rivalry is always a fun one. And, you know, I've been in total baseball mode, so I haven't looked at the whole full slate. But the Big Ten slate is pretty pretty lame this week. I think you have LSU-Florida, which will be a good one. Steve Spurrier said he made like a bet with Wes Miles there that he'll eat some grass if the Tigers knock off the Gators there. So that's, you know, it's a top 15 matchup. I think LSU comes in at number 5. Florida's somewhere between 10 and 15, I believe. And it's just one of these knock them out, drag them out SEC games. And it's kind of bad news for the Big Ten. You don't really have those marquee games. You had Northwestern, Michigan State, but Northwestern has struggled. And then outside of that, it's maybe Minnesota, Iowa for that Florida Rosedale trophy.
Yeah, they're kind of hamstrung because one side of their division is just weak as can be over there on the west side in the Big Ten, with Wisconsin and Iowa being the two best teams that they have, and they're just okay, or better than average, I guess you'd say. But after that, it just drops severely. You've got Northwestern, which is so-so, then you got Purdue, and you got Nebraska, which is obviously off to a historically bad start, so... Very weak division on the other side, and some of the other games on the east side haven't happened yet. You got Michigan State yet to happen, Michigan Penn State yet to happen, Michigan State Penn State. So some good games that'll be coming. They're just not going on right now, I guess, this early in the season.
Yeah, and there's it seems like a lot of teams have that open week at a time, like four or five Big Ten teams. Which maybe it's because there are 14 teams down in the Big Ten. It just seems like a lot to me, but. Maybe the schedule makers and this assumes that the people in the Big Ten office have half a brain, which is quite the assumption, is that, you know, you kind of need to have one of these, okay, this game is almost a guarantee to be a great game or a great matchup every week, and not count on, you know, Michigan State, Northwestern to be your banner game for the week.
Talking with Sammy Jacobs of Hoosier Huddle. You're a Yankees fan. Well, you've got the series that you dream of. I haven't had it for 14 years. The Sox and the Yankees are be going at it.
Oh, it's going to be fun. Hopefully it ends up better than the last time. With no more Jimmy Fallon movies being made about it. But it's going to be a bloodbath. You heard the Yankee fans that, you know, once that game was put in the bag, chant, "We want Boston," and, you know, they came in 14 years ago, ended the curse, and Yankee fans are, you know, they want their redemption, and, you know, we'll see. It's two of the biggest rivals in sports, and I know some people in the Midwest are kind of sick of that, but this is, trust me, growing up on the East Coast, this rivalry is as good as it gets in terms of bad blood and fights. And things like that. We generally, genuinely do not like each other. I don't like the people from Boston. They don't like me and other Yankee fans. So there's a good bad blood rivalry there, Jim.
How do you see that turning out this year? I mean, Boston's got a heck of a squad.
Well, it's going to come down to starting pitching. If Chris Sale, Chris Sale's the key. If he could pitch well for Boston and pitch well deep into the games, that makes that starting rotation that much better. But if he struggles to get through five innings, and you have to rely on David Price and Rick Porcello and some of those other, you know, second line starters, the Yankees have a shot. And they've hit David Price pretty well over the past, you know, decade with him there. And Rick Porcello doesn't really put the fear of God into that many people. And the Yankees are finally healthy. You got Aaron Judge back. Gary Sanchez is back, even though he hit 181. But this series is going to be, one that baseball is going to market as one of the best, because they have a heck of a team. They won 108 regular season games. Yeah, J.D. Martinez there with 40-some-odd home runs, and Mookie Betts is probably your AL MVP, and it's going to be must-watch TV.
Looking forward to it. Thank you so much for joining us as well. We'll look forward to see what happens on Saturday up in Columbus as the Indiana Hoosiers visit the Buckeyes, number two in the country. It'll definitely be a daunting task.
Yep, definitely will be, Jim. Thanks for having me on, and I'll see you tomorrow.
Yes, sir. Have a great one and a safe trip. Sammy Jacobs from Hoosier Huddle. Check out all of his content there at HoosierHuddle.com. Brought to you by Kentuckiana's Premier Truck Center. Whether it's one truck or the entire fleet, Kentucky has Premier Truck Center. They've got your company covered for sales or service. Locations in Louisville and Clarksville. Specialists in Hino, Volvo, Cummings, and Mack trucks. But they've got any and everything taken care of. Check them out. Kentuckiana's Premier Truck Center.
Tim texted in the middle of that. I couldn't get to the text, but he asked, do you think Tom Allen was not pushing his players in the second half of the Rutgers game to save them for Ohio State?
I don't think he was not pushing them. I think that they got extraordinarily conservative on the offensive side. Defensively, they had their hands full because they were scoring and they were having to deal with Rutgers, but Indiana wasn't doing squat. They didn't score in the second half, did they?
I don't think so, no.
Yeah, no, they just – it was crazy. It's just – the offense is just a mess, to be honest with you. You've got an average quarterback that is very – that is limits what you can do. Then you have an offensive coordinator who – not very imaginative. Let's just leave it at that. So, not a great combination for an offense.
I'd have been interested to see how that game would have played out in the second half for Indiana's offense had Rutgers matched them score for score in the first half. Because, I mean, you obviously at that point you can't play conservative. You got to keep continuing to play to win.
Well, what I don't understand is they call two almost back-to-back trick plays in a game when they were up 21-7. I'm like, really?
Let's master the normal plays before we start throwing.
How about they use that when they could have used it against Michigan State, sure, when they couldn't do a damn thing otherwise? They couldn't run a play. They couldn't throw a pass. Well, that's when you run a trick play and when you need some extra room, when you need to get outside of the defense's head for a second because they obviously have you blanked and have you covered. You don't do it when you're up 21-7 and you don't need it. You don't break that out. You don't show that. You save that. Now everybody has tape on that. Now everybody knows. It just doesn't. Nothing they are doing offensively makes sense. Nor do I understand. Now I don't have to understand it. It's not a requirement. But I think I got enough common sense when it comes to football that I can. I do understand it. That I to formulate an opinion. It's not making sense, but I'm not the only one that has this opinion. So
maybe it's not such a manila offense and they're just saving all the good stuff for Ohio State. That's the optimist in me.
Why? You can't beat Ohio State. But see, that's something they would do. They would bust it out. Instead of saving it for an Iowa, a game you can win, saving those trick plays for Iowa, a game where you will need them. Don't get it. Don't understand it. But it's going to be interesting to see what happens.
What is that? Is that a 12 o'clock game?
4 p.m. kickoff on Fox Sports. Remember Tom Allen?
Yeah, that's right.
Giving us the... you should have recorded that and made that a promo.
I need to. I still got it.
4 p.m. kickoff. Fox Sports.
Thanks.
He was laughing. He's such a character. He's a funny dude. Good guy. Good guy. I want him to get he's got to get an offensive coordinator, man. Want him to have success. Want him to do well. A great person. A good person to have leading a program from a personal standpoint. He's just got to get an offensive coordinator. Their offense stinks. I mean, it shouldn't. They've got talent. They've got lots of talent. Running back, receivers, line. But what's the most important position on the field?
Quarterback.
Exactly. Exactly.
Tim texts in and says, if we don't turn the ball over, I believe we can be competitive. 502-414-1450 is the text in number if you'd like to do the same.
I'm wondering if they can be competitive this week. Again, you never hear me say that. I always find a way sees them with the ability to be there. I just don't see a path in this one. I mean, I'm just not going to sugarcoat it. This could be rough.
And that's so, you've said it multiple times this week, it's more so because of Ohio State's firepower, not what Indiana can't do.
In this particular instance.
Combo.
Combo. Ohio State is just tough. They're good. They're deep. They're good three deep, man. They're just way, way, way better. They're better coached. My God, they've got four head coaches over there. Four. You got Urban Meyer, Greg Schiano, Kevin Wilson, and who was the dude that was the interim head coach when Meyer was gone? It wasn't either one of those two.
No.
So you got four head coaches right there. Indiana doesn't have a single head coach that's been a head coach prior to this job.
True.
So they're greatly out being outdone on the coaching end of it. So there's that. We got to take a break. We'll be back with more here on Indiana Sports Beat. Stay with us here on this Friday. We're giving away free lunches. Hey, if you're in the market for a new truck or tractor, car, or ATV, you need to be at Hollis Auction Service on November the 10th. Located on Highway 150 in Greenville, just west of Highway 335, Hollis Auction Service also needs items for the auction. If you're looking to sell, call Billy Joe Hollis today at 502-664-1606. That's 502-664-1606. Make sure you're at Hollis Auction Service in Greenville on November 10th. Welcome back to Indiana Sports Beat here on this Friday, TGIF. So thankful for it. Looking forward to it. Supposed to rain today. Man, that's good napping weather.
Yep.
A lot of weekend sports lined up. High school games tonight. You got a game tonight?
Seymour, New Albany.
Might be a better game than people anticipate.
I think it's going to be a hell of a game.
Seymour has improved this year. They're doing well. They're actually ranked
5-2.
So, New Albany, on the other hand, a team that everyone thought was going to be great, they're sitting at what, 3-3, 4-3?
Yep, 4-3. But they have had two losses to Bedford and Columbus East by a combined total of 2 points.
True.
But yeah, it's going to be fun tonight. I think it's going to be a really good game.
Well, yeah, I mean, New Albany's got a good team. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah.
There's just a lot of good teams in the Hoosier Hills Conference this year. Unusual.
Yep.
Unusual.
Columbus East still going to win it, but no surprise there.
Yeah, that'll come down between Bedford and Columbus. That'll be a hell of a game.
Yep.
That'd be one to see. I'd sure like to see that game. Hey, here's your question for Free Lunch Friday from Bubba's and an Indiana basketball calendar.
What?
What year was the darkest day in Ohio State football history? Hit us up on the text line. 502-414-1450. That was a phrase uttered by a former Ohio State coach. It's the darkest day in Ohio State football history. Let us know what you think about that. I'd like to know what you think about the FBI college basketball corruption trial that's going on and all that was laid out yesterday by Brian Bowen Sr. on how basically he was making a living off of his son from the shoe companies, from Lalamere High School, from wherever it was all coming from.
AAU circuit.
I don't know where that money was coming from.
Yeah, it was coming from Adidas, too.
So, a lot of schools being laid out, a lot of names being thrown out. What's going to happen to these coaches that are currently coaching? Because virtually every name that's been thrown out is a coach at some point, place, right now. One is a head coach right now. Lots of assistance. What's going to happen with that? The NCAA not doing anything right now. They've been told to stand down by the FBI.
Seems like this week the FBI has been moving pretty quickly on this case. I'm wondering how much longer it's going to go before we finally know something.
Oh, it's just this. It's expected to last, I think, 4 to 6 weeks, this trial.
Then there'll be another one.
But see, here's the thing. These are the ones they caught. How about the guys that got away with it?
Yeah. You know there's tons of those.
Shit, yes. So I guess they just get lucky. But who all is going to get caught in this net? It's still unfolding. Names still coming out. There's other people that are coming forward that have immunities from prosecution, expected to be testifying next week, as was the deal that Brian Bowen Sr. received. He talked. He named names.
Be interesting to follow, for sure.
I haven't heard Rick Pitino's name yet, though.
Not yet. Give it time.
You think that's going to change? I mean, this was the biggest part, Brian Bowen.
Yeah. Maybe not. Who knows?
He never mentioned a single thing about Rick Pitino to my knowledge.
Pitino was mentioned in the article. But
I mean,
but yeah,
as far
not by Senior. No.
Yeah, no, I mean, as far as having any interaction, any knowledge.
Well, just because he's going to go up on the stand and tell some stuff doesn't mean he's going to spill it all.
Well, why would he not? What's he got to hide? Hell, he's told everything. He's told how he made a living off of his son's back.
Yeah.
Why would he not? What's there to hold? Yeah, it's interesting to see how it's going to fold out, play out, man.
Tim texts in and says, I already won, but I know the answer. I won't say it. Darkest day in Ohio State football history.
Yeah, that's an easy one.
Bubba's lunch. Floating head poster. Doesn't get any better.
But, and that game comes up tomorrow. 4 o'clock kickoff time on Fox. You can also listen to that game on Big X Sports Radio, The Call with Don Fisher. They'll be on at 3 with pregame. And then tonight you're doing the New Albany Seymour game.
Correct.
Games all over the place. Make sure you catch Tom Allen's coaches show here each Wednesday.
7 o'clock?
I believe so. And it won't be long that Archie Miller's coaches show will be starting on Thursdays. Coming along very, very soon. So their season getting underway. November 1st, the first game. They're, except for the double secret probation practice they're having with Loyola Chicago.
Maybe we should get Sister Jean lined up for an interview to let us know how that game went.
Not allowed to talk about it. It's a secret.
You can't talk about it after?
No, that's the whole point of having them secret scrimmage so that no one talks about it.
Surely at some point, though, there'll be some details leak out.
Well, the agreement between the coaches is to not let that out because it's to not allow scouting reports. It's for you to work on things that you want to work on against a like-minded, talented team, and you ask them, hey, can you do this to us, work on this, give us a zone, blah, 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 and vice versa. And then you don't want that coach to in turn talk about how it went. That's the whole point of you're working on it, to work out some stuff that maybe you're having an issue with. Well, you don't want that coach to go talk about, oh, Indiana, they're not good when you play a matchup zone.
Yeah.
You don't want that information getting out. But so no, I don't think we can get anything worked out with Sister Jean, unfortunately. But she's more than welcome to come on anytime.
There it is, Kevin's our winner.
Or
1987, darkest day in Ohio State football history.
What was it?
Indiana beat Ohio State last time, right?
Well, not the last time, but the first time in a long, long time. They beat them actually successive years. They beat them the following year. It was kind of funny. Earl Bruce called that defeat to Indiana in Bloomington in 19, when was it, 87?
Yep.
The darkest day in Ohio State football history. I think they lost like 38-10.
Yeah.
The next year they lose 41-7. It was a much darker day in Ohio State history. But what was his name?
Days have been bright since. Kevin.
All right, Kevin. Your names will be up at Bubba's and your calendars will be there. So congratulations. Make sure you like or follow us on Facebook, IndianaSportsBeat.com. You can find us at iHeartRadio, iTunes as well. Had a good week. Looking forward to next week. Hoping to get Xander Damon on, Maurice Creek, Mitchell Page. It should be a huge week next week.
Yep.
Looking forward to it. Hope you had a great week this week and have a great week planned ahead of you. We've got some big games today on Ohio State. Plays on Saturday. That's going to pretty much wrap it up for us. For Justin Kalin, I'm Jim Coyle. I'll see you on the radio.